subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces eliminate Pakistan-backed terrorists in Kashmir. Kabul rocked by deadly suicide blast. Taliban rejects Ghani's call for ceasefire during Ramadan. And Al-Qaeda and Islamic State attribute COVID-19 as God's weapon against America. While the entire world is busy battling coronavirus pandemic together, LOC continues to remain a war zone owing to the constant firing and ceasefire violations by Pakistan to push infiltrators into Kashmir. However, the Indian security forces, despite suffering losses, managed to foil all its devious agendas. Recently, proactive Indian defense has successfully eliminated 6 Pakistan-backed terrorists in Kashmir Valley. And it's not a one-off breakthrough, but the forces have been successful in busting all the nefarious anti-India plots hatched in the corridors of Islamabad and Rawalpindi. A report.
Hours of relentless exchange of bullets killed 3 terrorists recently in Kashmir Shopian district. Security forces received a tip-off about terrorists hiding in Melhora area of the district, following which a search and cordon operation was launched that led to a gun battle as terrorists opened fire towards security forces. 3 security personnel also sustained injuries during the operation, who were later admitted to hospital. Moreover, Indian security forces also recovered a huge amount of arms and ammunition from the site of encounter. Earlier in another incident, Indian security forces neutralized 3 terrorists in South Kashmir's Kulgam district during a joint operation. Meanwhile, Pakistan Army has shamelessly continued its unprovoked ceasefire violations along the line of control despite the global lockdown due to coronavirus crisis. There have been several incidents of cross-border firing by Pakistan over the past month, leading to injuries and deaths of both civilians and soldiers. This week too, Pakistan launched unprovoked rounds of ceasefire violation by firing artillery guns and intense shelling along the LOC in Poonch district, targeting residential areas during the holy month of Ramadan. Civilians living in the targeted areas say that they are already living in fear due to the coronavirus pandemic, and this continuous firing from Pakistan's side has made their life more miserable.
पाकिस्तान की तरफ से आए किरनी कस्बा में रहता हूँ मैं, बहुत ज़्यादा फायरिंग हो रही है, फायरिंग हो रही है, ये आए दिन ये फायरिंग होती रहती है, लोग बहुत डरे हुए हैं, तो हम चाहते हैं कि ये रमज़ान के महीने में कम से कम ये फायरिंग बंद हो, बहुत ज़्यादा फायरिंग हो रही है, लोग डरे हुए हैं।
The world is fighting the COVID-19 outbreak with all available resources, and Pakistan is focused on pushing in terrorists through constant infiltration attempts in Jammu and Kashmir. There has been an unusual spike in ceasefire violations at the line of control these days, which is nothing but Pakistan's cheap tactics to divert world's attention and hide its incompetence at handling coronavirus spread.
Whenever we have seen, you know, internal crisis comes up, they try to divert attention towards, mainly towards India, Kashmir, you know, but centric policy they would adopt. They'll increase militant activities in the region, you know, and try to build up, you know, within the country, you know, there's a greater threat coming from India, need is to unite and try to divert their attention from employment or development towards India. They have been doing it.
Pakistan has continued to target Indian assets, not just militaristically, but also technologically. According to several media reports, Pakistan, in order to steal Indian data, created a fake mobile app replicating Arogya Setu, the healthcare application released by the Indian government that lets a user know if a COVID-19 patient is in the vicinity. However, Indian intelligence agencies have successfully thwarted all its devious tricks of exporting terrorism to India. Pakistan's reported coronavirus cases have climbed to 15,525 with more than 343 deaths, but Pakistan is continuing with its old malicious agendas of harming India. Pakistan Army generals who are at the helm of forming policies against India must realize at this point that all their strategies have proven to be counterproductive. It is in their interest if they stop hatching anti-India plots and focus on the welfare of their people.
With no relief at sight, even after a peace deal, Afghan civilians are suffering from the brunt of terrorism as a suicide bomb blast rocked Kabul province of Afghanistan this week. The attack comes at the very onset of the holy month of Ramadan, following a denial by the insurgent group to go for a ceasefire during Ramadan as proposed by the Afghan government. A report. A suicide bombing in Kabul province, not far from Afghanistan's capital, killed three people and wounded 15 on April 29th. The government blamed the Taliban for the attack, which took place a day after the country's defense minister and the commander of US forces in Afghanistan visited the facility. A suicide bomber detonated his explosives among civilians, informed the Interior Ministry spokesman Tariq Aryan, adding that the blast happened in the Char Asiab district of Kabul province, about 11 kilometers from the capital.
صدای مفجر شنیدم اومدم بیرون از خانه اومدم بیرون تفلک ها وام ورخطا شده بودن خب بسیاری جا خانه مردم هست کل طفل داره خرد داره مریض داره اومدم بیرون که سه چهار نفر زخمی شده بود تقریبا زخمی ها زیاد بودن تعداد شهید دارم میگم براتون
Earlier in the same week, 9 people were killed and 7 were hurt in a Taliban attack on security checkpoints controlled by pro-government militia in northern Samangan province. Dozens of Afghan security forces and Taliban fighters have been dying almost daily, with civilian casualties rising across the country as both sides ramp up operations. Civilians of this war-torn nation continue to live in despair because of this never-ending violence.
ایجا نمیگیم که دولت خدای نقصه بالای دولت فشار بیاریم دولت ایجا بکشه ما میکوشیم ما غریب و بیچاره هستیم دولت تحت تامین به حساب بکنه اولیکامون را بگیره ما به یک جای امنیت میریم چه های نظامی ده ایجا سر زندگی بکنه دیگه ما به کلی به جان آمدیم خدا یکیست که
The Taliban have launched 55 attacks each day since the deal signing in Doha on February 29th. Analysts say the bloodshed was predictable or inevitable given the wording of the deal and the sweeping concessions the US granted its foe of more than 18 years. Violence in Afghanistan is spiraling out of control, and experts say a fragile peace process risks collapse. The chances of peace returning in Afghanistan are hanging on a thread, as Taliban has put down the Afghan government's proposal to implement a ceasefire in Afghanistan for the holy month of Ramadan and to let authorities focus on tackling the coronavirus pandemic. Over and above, Taliban has not shown any sign of stopping its attacks despite signing the peace deal with the United States, which has led to the killing of more than 500 civilians in the first quarter of 2020. A report.
Hopes for a breakthrough in a push to end Afghanistan's grueling conflict suffered a major setback as Taliban rejected an Afghan government call for a ceasefire for the Muslim holy month of Ramadan, raising new concern about prospects for a fragile peace process. Afghan president appealed to Taliban to lay down their arms for the month of Ramadan as the country is battling the crisis of coronavirus pandemic. Afghanistan has detected more than 1,800 cases of the virus, but health experts say the number could be higher as testing is limited and Afghanistan's weak health system would struggle with a widespread outbreak. However, Taliban did not consider the appeals even on humanitarian grounds, as the fast-spreading coronavirus threatens to overwhelm the country's feeble health system. A Taliban spokesman, Sohail Shahin, said in a post on Twitter that a ceasefire would be possible if the peace process was being implemented fully, but hurdles meant the Taliban would not yet lay down their arms, and asking for ceasefire is not rational and convincing. Hopes for an end to Afghanistan's decades of war were raised in a late February when the Taliban and the United States struck a deal on the withdrawal of US-led foreign forces in exchange for Taliban security guarantees. The deal said the Afghan government would release 5,000 Taliban prisoners, while the armed group would free 1,000 Afghan security force personnel, which was supposed to have concluded by now, but the process has been beset with problems. Although the Afghan government released 100 prisoners from a prison near Bagram Air Base as a first step in the peace process with the hardline Islamists, the lack of understanding and string of confusions is leading to delayed productivity on various crucial issues.
The current situation is that there are a number of discrepancies in the speeches of the different actors, and I see the positions of the different actors. And I think one of the reasons that they have not come to a ceasefire agreement is because there are lots of different Taliban troops. The problem is that when they cannot come to an agreement on the very important issues which are critical into the agreement between US and the Taliban, which actually create conflict inside the Afghanistan debate, that actually create obstacle for coming to an agreement. One of the major problem with this current two contracts is the release of the 5,000, which is not any sign of an agreement. There is no sign of such an agreement between Afghan government and the United States.
Moreover, Taliban has been continuously carrying out deadly attacks, killing dozens of Afghan security forces and civilians on a daily basis. According to United Nations, more than 500 civilians were killed in Afghanistan in the first 3 months of the year, as violence raised even after the peace agreement signed between United States and Taliban. The UN Assistance Mission in Afghanistan said in its quarterly report that fighting in the first 3 months caused 1,293 civilian casualties, of which 760 were injuries and the rest deaths, including 152 children and 60 women. The US-led NATO alliance also called out the Taliban to cut violence levels and join peace talks. In an official statement, alliance ambassador in NATO's North Atlantic Council said that the current level of violence caused by the Taliban is not acceptable.
The Islamic fundamentalist groups have not deterred themselves from misusing the grim medical situation to forward their ulterior motives. Calling COVID-19 the God's smallest soldier, the ISIS and Al-Qaeda have upped their propaganda against the West by hailing the current medical scenario as Allah's wish and extracting an opportunity to execute terror plans by recruiting new jihadis at the behest of the coronavirus pandemic.
While much of the United States and Europe has been staying home to avoid COVID-19 as it kills thousands, terrorist groups are blasting online propaganda messages towards followers and potential recruits, hailing the calamity of the disease as divine retribution. According to a private SIT intelligence group, the ISIS and Al-Qaeda have each claimed that the highly contagious and deadly coronavirus is God's wrath upon the West, and the disease itself is a soldier of Allah. In a statement distributed by its propaganda arm, As-Sahab, Al-Qaeda says that Allah, the Creator, has revealed the brittleness and vulnerability of Western world's material strength. It is now clear for all to see that West's prosperity was nothing but a deception that could not stand the test of the smallest soldier of God on the face of the earth.
The problem with all these Islamic fundamentalists is that they always try to misrepresent and try to mislead all their people who are following the Islamic religion. It has been seen that these people, first of all, they will never tell the truth to their public. Second is, they will always try to twist that, whatever is happening, and try to project it in such a way that this is the word of God, the word of Allah, as they call it. There is a very video that is viral with the Tablighi Jamaat chief of Pakistan weeping on the video, and with Prime Minister Imran Khan and his cabinet colleagues also praying to God, and he's weeping and telling Allah, ki, why are you doing this to us? So this sort of attitude of these people is just to mislead and misrepresent everything to their followers, so that they keep the hatred for the non-believers in Islam and America, which is in the forefront, right on top.
Both Al-Qaeda and Taliban share links with terror-breeding nation Pakistan and are also functioning there in isolation under the nose of the Pakistani government. In South Asia, Al-Qaeda enjoys an upper hand over any other terrorist organization because of the long-term relationships it has established with local and regional Islamist groups working in alliance with the Pakistan's army and inter-services intelligence. For ISIS, it was a challenge to gain a foothold in the Pakistan-Afghanistan region known as Islamic State Khorasan Province, or ISKP, because the area was already controlled by Al-Qaeda and its associated groups. While Al-Qaeda and its affiliates remain a threat to the US homeland, the Islamic State's danger is more to the stability of the Middle East and US interests overseas. On its official online publication Al-Naba, ISIS said, the pandemic's impact has killed more Americans than the nearly 3,000 who died in Al-Qaeda's 9/11 attacks. It shows that America isn't all-powerful and invincible. It is falsehood to worship America and to fear it instead of Allah, the Almighty, ISIS said in its message.
Pakistan has nothing to offer to its own countrymen, nothing to offer to anyone. Today also, if you see in Afghanistan, most of the attacks that are taking place, the Afghanistan government is blaming Pakistan for it. This Islamic State and the Al-Qaeda, they have a very deep-rooted links with Pakistan, and which neither Pakistan wants to let go, nor these two organizations.
Terrorism experts point out, jihadi groups have a propensity for calling any natural disaster the will of God, exacting vengeance on Western powers that have been waging war on them for more than two decades. Colonel Chris Costa, a retired US Army intelligence officer, is of the view that the terrorist groups are opportunistic and are taking advantage of a pandemic by suggesting this is divine retribution. The terrorists believe if they cannot beat Americans on the battlefield, they can beat them through God's vengeance. Bleeding the US economy dry has always been a goal of the terrorist group, and the financial cost of 9/11 was something its late leader Osama bin Laden often spoke of as a great success. Aaron Zellin, an expert author on ISIS, asserts while ISIS is taking a totalitarian vision, Al-Qaeda is trying for hearts and minds by calling on Westerners to use time at home to study Islam and consider joining with jihadis. Both groups have called upon followers to be ready to strike in violent attacks, as thousands of cops in the United States have been put on sick leave or tested positive for COVID-19.
Calling for their people to attack in America, I think, is quite, they're living in fool's paradise, because this is not going to help them in any way. And America is not that weakened that its law and order machinery has collapsed.
In a warning late last week, the US Department of Homeland Security told police around the country that there are no known plots. According to the intelligence bulletin released by a private media house, violent extremists probably are seeking to exploit public fears associated with the spread of COVID-19 to incite violence, intimidate targets, and promote their ideologies, and we assess these efforts will intensify in the coming months. There is no telling where the coronavirus will strike in the coming months, but spinning natural disasters in the homelands of their enemies is a default reaction by jihadi groups overseas, say the experts who monitor these terrorist groups.
Regions under Pakistan's forceful occupation are suffering through a host of issues, terrorism being the most prominent among them. Innocent civilians are being manhandled at the hands of Pakistan Army since decades. Further, terrorists are assigned the job of killing these innocents to suppress their voices of dissent. Gilgit-Baltistan has been the worst sufferer of these atrocities, and its security situation is also worsening with the proliferation of terror factories in this occupied region, a report.
The security situation in Gilgit-Baltistan, the territory that has been reeling under Islamabad's illegal occupation for more than 7 decades, has become increasingly fragile as the homegrown terrorists of Pakistan are unleashing mayhem in the region. Operating in the line of Islamabad's larger agenda of oppressing locals in Gilgit-Baltistan, these terrorists are on a rampage to kill innocents. They have escalated their violent activities exponentially in order to muzzle the reasonable voices seeking their fundamental rights and to further heighten the prevailing sense of fear amongst the locals. The terror factories, which were brought into being with the direct support of army generals and an exclusive aim of carrying out Pakistan's proxy war against India and Afghanistan, are now perpetrating brutalities on locals of Gilgit-Baltistan. Malik Muhammad Miskin, a former speaker of Gilgit-Baltistan Assembly, says that current situation was a direct consequence of the terror that was nurtured in GB territory in the name of Islam.
जो ट्रेनिंग कैंप वगैरह बनाए गए थे वो इसलिए बनाए गए थे कि यहाँ के जो मुजाहिदाना ज़हन रखने वाले लोग जो है ना उनको कश्मीर या अफगानिस्तान भेजा जाए और यही हुआ वो खुलम खुला था पूरे पाकिस्तान से मुजाहिदीन भेजे जाते थे तो यहाँ से भी जो थोड़े बहुत थे वो चले गए वहाँ पे उन्होंने जिहाद किया ये उसी का रिएक्शन है
Recent attacks on the girls' schools in Dhiamar are a testimony to the fact that these radicals who do not want GB people to progress are targeting the soul of civilization, women. They want regressive patriarchal laws to govern the people. The security agencies, which are responsible for the safety of people, have merely acted on the messenger of sad news and released regular templates to pacify the citizenry. Instead of waging a war against terrorism, they have been implicating the innocent youth of GB on false charges invoking the draconian Schedule 4.
इससे पहले भी 2005 में ये अटैक्स हुए थे 2008 में भी हुए थे लेकिन उन अटैक्स में और इन अटैक्स में फ़र्क ये था कि ये थोड़े से मास लेवल पे थे उस टाइम पे इतने नहीं हुए थे दूसरा फ़र्क ये था उस टाइम पे पुलिस ने किसी ने कोई रिएक्ट नहीं किया था
Although the current dispensation of Pakistan has issued the rhetoric of eliminating the homegrown terrorism, any change in the status quo is unlikely as the deep state of the army, which holds greater sway in the domestic as well as external affairs of the country, has got its back. However, a mounting rage amongst the informed locals of the region and their resolve to get their share of rights has hit the suppressive leaders of Islamabad hard, forcing them to change their policies vis-a-vis the occupied territory. A mounting international pressure on Islamabad after it was greylisted by the Financial Action Task Force and the United States suspending $300 million security assistance has further cornered Pakistan.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Savijay signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.